Call meeting, special agenda for the purpose of a public hearing and other administrative matters. Fellow Commissioners, I would like to request that we review the agenda briefly and would propose one change. After the public hearing, after our speakers, and after the public hearing comes to a close, you see we do have two amendments and requests for transfer of funds, which would open up to a regular general business meeting. Prior to that, it's been suggested, and I think we should allow public comments separate from the public hearing. I have a request for one, so I'd like to insert public comments there before item number four, following the close of the public hearing, if that's all right with everybody. And if it is, could we go ahead and just approve the agenda with that change, unless you all have other changes? If there are no other changes, can we have a motion?
I move we approve it as
second
with the addition.
All right. Thank you. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Very good. All right. We'll start out the meeting with the invocation from Commissioner Linda Massey.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you that we can gather here today to have this public hearing, and we just praise your name, Lord, and we just hope that, that we can do the right thing today, and we these things that we ask in your name, Lord, as we pray today and as we look towards the future for our county. Amen.
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 Thank you, Linda. This is a public hearing. Unlike our normal meetings, the public comments are not restricted to 3 minutes. Anyone that wants to speak about the project at hand, the issue that we hear, is free to do so. We would ask that you keep your comments targeted toward this specific public hearing. The purpose of the public hearing today is to consider and hear about economic development incentive opportunities to Burlington Technologies. That will be the subject of the public hearing. We'll open the public hearing at this time, and I don't really care what order we go in. Why don't we just start on this part of the room, and we'll just go across if that's satisfactory, and ask anyone that would like to speak at the public hearing to raise your hand. Yes, sir. Now, John, I've got you down for the regular comments. Do you wish to speak at the public hearing or the regular meeting?
That's the reason I'm here. I'm sorry, I probably should.
Okay, that's okay. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, if you like, we do have a small presentation. If you would like to see that before,
yeah, let's have that first, and then we'll do that. Mac, are you going to give the presentation?
I'll introduce the folks that are here.
Okay, please do. Come forward.
If that's the appropriate.
Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Commissioner, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners, sorry. Thank you for this opportunity to be here today. We appreciate the work that you all have done to be able to allow us to be here. I wanted to introduce some folks who are with the company, who will then in turn provide a presentation about the company and the project. The chairman and the CEO of the company, Burlington Technologies, is here, Mike Durham. Also, his associates in the management and principals of the company, Al Boylock and Robert Sills, are also here. In addition, the company is represented by Paul Kuntz, who is their corporate attorney. So we're delighted to have the four of them here. Between the four of them, I'm sure any question that you or members of the public might have, they can answer. So with that, we're delighted to have them here. And I guess, should Mr. Durham come up and make the presentation?
That'll be fine.
Okay.
Mike, welcome.
Thank you.
All right. Mac, thank you for the introduction. Chairman Manning, Board of Commissioners, and County Manager Mr. Honeycutt, appreciate your interest in our project and the time you've given us today. I also like to introduce a couple of gentlemen with me. We mentioned Robert Sills, but Robert and Al Boylock. Robert is our chairman, Al Boylock is our co-chairman of Burlington Technologies, or BT as we call it. I am Michael Durham, our president and CEO, and BT is headquartered at 1305 Graham Street, right here in Burlington. Today we are requesting your financial support to save a business that has met some adversity. And by obtaining the support of this board and others, we'd expect to bring new jobs to our Pioneer facility quickly. Before going into details about our project, I'd like to provide some brief background on our company. While BT as a company is only 3 years old, the group here today represents over 100 years of textile experience. Many of those years were their former employer, Burlington Industries. Given our backgrounds, we have common and historical ties with this county and city. For a bit of history, Burlington Mills would not have been formed without the help and support of community leaders and local governments like yourself. Burlington Mills began operations in 1924 at the Pioneer Plant, as shown in the picture on the slide, the same location as our headquarters today. You can't see it, but on the slide, there's a few Model Ts. We have a few less Model Ts in the parking lot today. I have borrowed from some historical archives to create this slide, and at the top it reads, "A community born of the railroad, bred on the loom, and built on ability to turn adversity into opportunity." With this board's help, BT hopes to turn adversity into opportunity once again by keeping a government contract in North Carolina that supplies dress pants for our military men and women. Burlington technology today resides in two former BI plants located in Alamance and Caswell counties. These plants were known as Pioneer and Williamsburg, respectively. While only partially utilized, these older plants total approximately 1 million square feet. We are a small business, but we do provide employment for 120 citizens of our communities, with 96% coming from the adjoining counties and 55% from Alamance alone. Our core business is providing dyed yarn and services, as well as woven decorative fabrics. These products serve many customers who compete in today's very competitive home furnishings, apparel, and hospitality markets. While our corporate name is Burlington Technologies, we go to market and are known by our customers by other names. BMS provides yarn services, and Seven produces fabrics for furniture. This August, we purchased a distressed company called Varelli. Varelli designs and markets fabric wall coverings for hotels and public spaces. They are now produced at a Williamsburg facility. Due to our largely underutilized facilities, we have sought business opportunities that not only take advantage of our space, but leverage our loyal workforce and experienced management team. An example is the company Vitaflex that was formed in December 2009. They began in our Pioneer facility to produce comfortable and stretchable non-woven protective hoods. While we assisted this company at startup, today is positioned to ship products to 300 Lowe's home improvement stores. Now for the details of our request. As mentioned in my letter to Mr. Honeycutt on December 19th, BT is trying to obtain a contract that supplies dress pants to the military. The contract had been previously supplied by Royal Park Uniform, located in Prospect Hill, North Carolina. During the later half of 2011, RPU became financially distressed when they lost funding from their bank. They subsequently filed for Chapter 7 bankruptcy this December. BT in this letter requested a $500 per job incentive to help offset expenses associated with hiring, equipment purchases, and relocation of the operation to our Pioneer facility. It was noted that we are also seeking financial support from the City of Burlington as well as the State of North Carolina. If we are successful in obtaining the contract and financial assistance, we would expect to hire 110 people right away. Once up and running, we'd expect to create 30 additional jobs by the second half of the year. By showing the military our capabilities and performance, we anticipate being awarded two additional contracts that could yield 54 more jobs. That would bring the total over a three-year period to 194 jobs being created. If we do not get the contract or financial assistance, these jobs and potential jobs will leave the state and most likely will move to New York. BT needs this financial assistance to, one, purchase and locate the required cut and sew equipment to our Pioneer plant, and two, retrofit approximately 75,000 square feet of space inside our plant in preparation of a move, and three, buy essential supplies and materials that will allow us to start this new business. The three-year anticipated expenses are shown on the slide in front of you and are expected to top $1 million. While this amount of dollars does not build a new facility, it does represent a sizable investment for a small company such as ours, and it does create jobs that will average over $23,000 per year in wages. This project is also a perfect fit for so many people in our community who remain unemployed today during this tough economic climate. Please help us put these folks back to work. In closing, I'd like to thank the county manager, Mr. Honeycutt, for bringing to the request this board, and thank the board and Chairman Manning for understanding the situation, reacting with such urgency in setting this public hearing, as well as the time you all have provided today. While BT understands our request for incentives does not fall within past routine programs, we do greatly appreciate the creative, out-of-the-box thinking you demonstrated in your performance contract. BT understands the criteria, the requirements, and also agrees to the conditions for the incentives. At this time, I'd like to ask if the commissioners or the county manager have any questions that I or my associates may answer.
Thank you, Mike. Any questions for Mike at this time?
Well, I've got just a series of four, and rather than just ask one at a time, I'd like to just read them off to you, basically, and paraphrase it the best I can, and you can address it that way.
Sure.
Feel like I've asked too many questions. I'd like to know if these positions are going to be permanent versus temporary. How long do you think, of course, you've insinuated you'll get future contracts, but how long do you think they'll be employed? Will you be using the E-Verify system? And also, will Alamance County, do you feel that the new hires will be basically Alamance County citizens if they have the qualifications?
Well, I got three, Mr. Sutton. You may have to give me the
permanent versus temporary. How long will they be employed, basically? Do you feel the law of averages?
Right.
Will you be using the E-Verify program and also Alamance County workers versus out-of-county workers?
Okay, I'll put one and two together then. We do not expect them to be temporary employees. We would hope they would be long-term employees. Certainly, the conditions of the military contract as it is today states a specific period of time. The other two contracts, they're normally 3 to a 5 year contract in nature when you would apply. So we would hope that we could keep these employees for a long time, and that by providing a value and good quality product, that we would be a prime candidate for future contracts. One of the things that the military does reward is gives a little extra assistance to companies that are small business. It's called a small business set-aside contract, and we would be a small business. As long as we remain under 500 employees, we would still qualify for that, so we should be in prime position, assuming that we perform, obviously. So we would, how long? We would hope for a long time. In today's climate, no one can predict or project exactly how long our jobs are available. The marketplace determines that. In terms of the E-Verify system, I'm not familiar with that, but we would certainly look into that and understand if that's a requirement for the incentives. We would try to comply to the best of our ability.
Matt, is it not a requirement just to hire people, whether you get incentives or not?
Is that number of employees?
It was it's a state issue if you are contracting. I think if you're a vendor from the state, I think that they worked on that was passed. But
I think they passed a law that said if you hire more than 25,
it's a number.
That I'm not sure, but if the board is agreeable with that, I think what we can do, and it's a very simple process for the E-Verify, we can add an addendum to the contract that basically states that all hires shall be E-Verified. And very similar to the wording we use on our contracts now.
Tim, you want to elaborate for those that may not be familiar with that system exactly what it is and what it's for?
Well, E-Verify has been accepted across the United States. If I'm not mistaken, Homeland Security endorses it, but it's where you check to see whether an applicant's a U.S. citizen or not. And if I'm not mistaken, in the past legislature, the state legislature approved that you had to use E-Verify if you have X amount of employees.
We can check. If they're doing federal contracts, they're going to have to.
That's no guarantee. Let me tell you why. I had a person tell me that there's an arms situation down in Lee County, and the company supposedly is full of illegal aliens. Now, that's what I've been told, and I believe it. So, no, I don't trust that at all. But I would like to know what state law says about numbers of employees in this manner, please.
Are you going to make a motion?
Yeah.
To add that? I'll second that motion.
Yeah. If it's as I think the state law reads.
Add it to the contract.
We may want to wait until we actually discuss the vote.
Overall vote, we can make it with.
If I could say also, even if the state law doesn't require, if it's something that this board would like to see as part of our incentive agreement that is important to you and they're agreeable with it, that's something we could add into the agreement, regardless of what the state law is at this point.
Well, we should be doing it.
Yes, sir.
Right.
And Ms. Sutton, your last question about how many would be from Alamance County, given our roots and right here in our backyard, we'd certainly expect and hope a lot of candidates would end up with the jobs, all the way up to 194. Obviously, we've got a contract that's very serious. We have to make sure we've got the best qualified people. We would interview the candidates right here in Burlington out of our Pioneer facility, and we would hope that as many as possible could come from this county or certainly this city as much as possible. But again, we will have to make sure that we've got the right candidates, assuming they're qualified.
Now, in Caswell, you had, those were laid off, is that correct?
That's right.
Okay, now will they have a priority to come over?
I don't see that they will have a priority. We will certainly have open interviews and still try to get the most qualified folks to do the contract. But whether they've been laid off or terminated, I think they probably have been terminated at this point, so it's not like a layoff situation where they'd come back. Also, as I understand it, they've been out of operations for a couple months. I wouldn't see that they would have necessarily a higher priority over someone else's local that's qualified. Still a lot of training would have to go on after 2 months of ceased operations.
Well, on an upbeat note, if you don't mind, I saw the picture of Spencer Love.
Yep.
And years ago, when I was like 12 years old, that's a long time ago, we were in Greensboro. My father was at a Burlington Industries meeting. He was with Burlington for quite a while. And I knew at even age 12 who Spencer Love was. And Mom and Dad had gone out to eat, and I'm there at the motel, and they came in on the television and said Spencer Love had died playing tennis down in Florida, if I'm not mistaken. So Dad came back in the room, and I told him about it, and he got on the phone immediately and called people. But I'm very familiar with Burlington Industries and textiles and so forth, so good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. I think just to add to Tim's question about the fourth item, do we really even know how many employees that Royal Park lived in Caswell versus Alamance versus Orange County? I don't see how you would even have that data.
I don't know that information.
May I make a comment? I have toured your plant over at Pioneer. About 3 years ago, wasn't it, Eddie? Did you go to that too? And I was very impressed because they have like four or five different operations. I don't know how many you still have. And I was very impressed with the facility over there. I just want to tell everybody that I couldn't believe everything I was seeing because they have one thing here and one thing here, and you went through the plant, and eventually I think you had four then, maybe. You're making some kind of bottle caps or something, or some kind of mask.
Right.
Is that right?
Yes.
Okay.
You remember a good number?
I do. So I just want to thank you for allowing us to come out there.
Sure. Thank you, and thank you for your support. The comment about Mr. Love, he blessed us with some very large facilities that we have. It's kind of a double-edged sword. Very large facilities. Now we're trying to find as many businesses right that can fit in there and make a go of it.
Right. Well, I want to thank you for that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. Other comments from commissioners?
I just, to piggyback on what Linda's saying, and just to see that you guys have the vision to use these spaces that we have all over Alamance County. I mean, we are very blessed with big buildings and things to do, but we need companies such as yourself to come in here and actually have the foresight to figure how to use these facilities and make them work. I commend you for what you've done
there.
Thank
you.
As this is a public hearing and this information was available, are these slides available in paper form for anyone that would want to?
We could get them in paper form. They're not today. We've got one set that's in paper form, but I'd be glad to get others.
We have the presentation loaded, and we can put it on the website as well if you'd like.
Okay. Very good. Any other questions for Mike? Well, prior to calling on our citizens, Craig or Mac, do you all wish to follow up with anything related to the presentation or any other comments you may have?
Thank you. The only comment I would have would be again to add an exclamation point to the sense of urgency with which the county manager and this board responded to this need. I was in a meeting with these guys of what I thought was just going to be an update on where we are, and it became evident that if we're going to do what we're doing, we needed to do it that day. And I think that was the day you guys were having a meeting. And so Craig did what he needed to do, and you guys responded with what you needed to do. So I can't thank you enough for the urgency. Oftentimes, to be competitive for projects like this, it's about as much time as it is money, and time is money. And so I just wanted to reiterate, he already said something, but I wanted to emphasize how much I appreciate on behalf of the county to working with these folks. When time was of the essence, you guys responded, as did Burlington as well. So I just want to reiterate that and say thank you.
Thank you, Mac.
Mr. Chairman, just to give you kind of the highlights of the proposed contract, is what they're looking for is a commitment of $500 per job with a maximum of 110. As you've heard, they may go more. They may go up to 146. They may eventually go up to 180. The county's commitment would only be to 110 jobs, and those commitments would be for a period of 3 years.
So $55,000?
Yes, sir. Would be the max. But that is a commitment for...
Over 3 years' time?
One time. It's a one time, yes, sir. Okay. It's a one-time payment, but the commitment for the jobs is over 3 years, and we would check annually with the Employment Security Commission, make sure that the job numbers remained at least at 110.
And if they don't?
There are callback provisions available within inside the agreement.
Okay. Any questions for Craig or for Mike? Okay, well, why don't we start? Randy, anybody on the second row wish to speak? Third row, John, welcome. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you. John Oaks, Burlington. Appreciate the opportunity to speak to you today. Like most people, I prefer issues to be black and white. That's how I try to approach things in my life. Unfortunately, this issue, like many issues in life, is gray. It's one of those present-day governmental monetary issues that can make a person look like he or she is talking out of both sides of his or her mouth. Cash incentives for business by local and state governments is a modern-day reality. Only an irrational, dogmatic person would attempt to argue and disagree with that statement. Personally, I think government incentives are wrong because it's tax money. It's not private capital. However, there's the other side of my mouth. I do support and encourage you to provide the $55,000 incentive to Burlington Technologies. It is my understanding that it will create 110 new jobs. However, I would like to premise this. If you do approve this, don't try to micromanage a business, telling them who they can hire in what county, although I'm hopeful and confident, although I don't know anyone here, that most people in business are good people, and fundamentally, if they're coming to Alamance County, are going to try to hire people from Alamance County. That would be a rational assumption. However, you have to have people in positions. I don't know the expertise needed. You have to have qualified people. But primarily because if you vote today to oppose this incentive on principle only, it will have a nil, zero effect on stopping this type of practice. If you choose to vote against this today, it will only affect the 110 people that will benefit at a personal level and are highly likely to be residents of Alamance County at a local level, you know, when you're considering the tax revenue benefit to the residents of Alamance County in general. Again, personally, I do not support government incentives, but these issues have been addressed at the least. I mean, these issues at best have to be addressed at the least at a state and a federal level, because if there is not a standard agreement at the state and federal level, a business will locate the counties in our state that do provide incentives, or another state, because it's rational for a business to make their decisions on monetary bottom line. That's what businesses have to do, because unlike governments, they go away if they make the wrong decisions. I would encourage you today to approve this $55,000 in incentives, and I would also encourage each of you to agree to discuss publicly, either today or at some point in the future, how you can collectively, as a county board, officially contact and influence our state and federal representatives, perhaps through a proclamation, encouraging them to write, adopt, and pass legislation that would not permit government incentives to be paid to business at government at any level. Until such time, it is not rational to dismiss considering these types of incentives on a principle alone, because all it will do is have an adverse effect on the citizens in Alamance County and the surrounding area. And I thought about this morning. I thought $500 per job for these gentlemen and ladies to start this business here. Although I haven't done the due diligence or crunched the numbers, I'm confident that over a period of time, that three-year time, is it rational to think that we'll definitely get the benefit of that $500 back plus more from people spending and buying and being taxed. So that being said, I would offer this for final consideration. I used to have a small business. You know, I used to ask my employees, they used to all wanted guarantees all the time. I used to say, who's guaranteeing me anything, guys? I'm just grateful to have food, clothes, and shelter. But the reason why I say that is I had to sign things personally, and I had to guarantee things personally. So if in my best assessment things didn't work out, nobody cared. They're knocking on my door, John, we need to be reimbursed for the loan, or et cetera, or, you know, capital expenditures, those types of things. So my question is it reasonable, and I think Mr. Honeycutt said it, there was provisions in there, is the $55,000 secured or collateralized in any way, or is there or could there be a provision that would state a promise to pay or repay the $55,000 if for some reason these plans did not come in, you know, we actually didn't create the jobs? And I appreciate the opportunity to speak. I would like to encourage you to approve the sheriff's purchase of the 8 vehicles and the cameras. So, thank you.
Thank you, John. How about the last row, John, or anybody else back there would like to speak? Chris? Ann? Okay. We'll turn to this side, county staff. Clyde, we'll like to ask you in a few minutes maybe to clarify that you verify what is appropriate and how it would be worded. Anyone else from the company? Robert's good to see you, sir. Paul?
I think.
Comments? Pete. Third row, Henry, y'all want to speak? Okay. Come forward and then introduce yourself.
Thank you, Commissioner. My name is Henry Vines, and I'm from Snow Camp. I come to you today. I've got a few things that I want to discuss. And first of all, I'd like to know why the information wasn't posted on the website to start with, so that we could, as citizens, look at this proposal and make our own decision before coming here and having to come to this public meeting. I went on, and there was nothing on the front page, even identifying that this meeting was taking place today. I also went into the packet, and the packet was blocked, which I was in y'all's packet, about this presentation. So I think, you know, that we really need, you know, be informative to the citizens to know this, so we can get make a fair assessment. The second thing is that it was said 3 years. Well, according to the contract, it's 2 years. After this company meets their benchmark in 2 years of 110, then they are not obligated to return any money. That's on number 11.
It should have been, I think, 3 years is what we talked about four, then we went to three. Is that correct, or?
The packet says two.
Yeah, that's
what the contract says.
Yeah, We'll have to, we'll have to verify that, but it was, our basic understanding that it was free.
Well, that was,
and I apologize for missing that.
Well, that's my concern, is that, you know, we're looking at a 2-year commitment of this company that potentially they could pull out in 2 years and keep the monies that they've got. I don't have anything against these folks, and I appreciate y'all's opportunity to come into this county and bring employment. But as an ex-Burlington industry employee, where it was shut down on the whim, you know, of poor management in my decision, in my opinion, I know that these things can happen, and the money goes with them. The other thing that brings up concern of mine is that, can this county afford this? We, as a county here, and as a citizen, have been looking for ways to get money for revenues for this county, to pay our own bills. How can we afford to pay out money when we don't even have money to pay out for our own needs and wants? But we need these finances to do the county's businesses. I agree with, you know, bringing jobs to our community, and I know we need these jobs. But I just feel like that this is the wrong time for us to be putting out money to a company that's established, that has a contract pending, that is potentially, according to all I have is what was written in the papers, of millions of dollars of revenue coming into this company. I can't understand why they need $55,000 of taxpayers' money to make this happen. It looks like to me as this is such a good adventure that they'd be willing to go on this on their own and then be a good citizen of this community and hire people and keep this, you know, keep our county, you know, viable and going forward. Commissioners, I have to say that as a citizen, I oppose this. I hate that I have to say this, but I do. I feel like this is the wrong time. We're $4.5 million in the deficit, possibly facing that same deficit next year if there's not revenues or cuts made. And for us to just give out $55,000 and asking our county employees to take days off and losing salaries, our employees have not had raises in the last 3 years. As the old adage is, charity starts at home. I asked you commissioners to look at this as you think about this as in approving this, is that we're spending more money. Spending needs to stop, period. We have been created over $15 million worth of debt in the last 2 years. All these interest rates are nice and fine. They're good, but the principal's got to be paid back. So I encourage you not to pass this incentive. I would encourage y'all to stay and make this happen here in Alamance County. But I cannot, as a citizen, support this. And I thank you for your time.
Thank you, Henry.
Okay. Sir, yes, sir. Come forward.
I just stand here.
Come to the mic, please, because you're being amplified into the other room. Welcome you. Please introduce yourself, and you are not limited to 3 minutes, as you have been in the past.
Thank you. Peter Childers, for the record. Mr. Durham, have you got this contract already? Have you bid on it? So this getting this money is part of the bid process, is that correct? Are there other bidders on this contract?
Not sure.
I would imagine. Okay. Is that not something the government would disclose, that there are other bidders?
The military may, but they have not disclosed it to us.
Okay. So you could possibly be the only bidder on this contract. Is that correct?
I'm not sure.
I said you could be.
Could be.
You could be. Okay. I just kind of get an idea of Burlington Technologies. I did some research, and there's been some bankruptcies and layoffs and reorganizations and buyouts and things like that of the company. So Burlington Technologies, what kind of sales did you have last year? I'm trying to understand the size of the company at this point.
That is private information. We're a private company, and we don't disclose ourselves to the public.
Okay. So I guess what I'm leading to then is I'm trying to understand why you need the $55,000. You're not willing to disclose to us any of your company's financials to say that this is money that the county provides because you need it. I know that you want it. Every company that comes in here asking for incentives wants the money. Every citizen that comes in here and asks the county for services wants those services. But you're not willing to disclose to the public or to the county commissioners why you need the money. I mean, if it was a question of that the company was on hard times and this money would really lower the bid and guarantee that we'd get this contract and whatnot, but there's none of that in here. So I just don't know. Could you tell us why you need the money?
Sure. As a matter of fact, if we could go back to the, I don't know if you've still got the slide there, but we could go back to the $1 million that's required to bring the equipment in.
Mike, I'm sorry, but again, if you're going to speak,
and
we need you in the mic, I'm sure so everybody can hear you. Peter, don't go away.
Don't worry.
Peter, there's about $1 million there that's required over a 2 to 3 year period, a lot of money up front that's required to buy equipment and move the operation in. We are on tough times. While we may have a private policy not to disclose our numbers, the talk about furloughs with the county, our company's also gone through that. Many of our employees have been furloughed when there's tough times. We have to hire employment or bring employment as our sales go up and down. Our customers determine that. The money that's required up front, we don't have that $1 million up front to bring those jobs in or bring that equipment in. If we had the equipment and it was a very lucrative contract, which many times these military contracts are not that lucrative from what I've seen.
But don't you know when you go into the bid process how lucrative this contract's going to be?
We do. And given this contract and given the cost per pants is fixed, the contract that exists. We would not be allowed to modify the contract. What we're asking for is the military to transfer the contract to us. So the price is fixed for the remaining life of the contract. Don't know many places where our costs are going to be fixed.
Yeah, so the advantage that you have in this situation is the government is giving you those numbers. You know all the numbers. The county here doesn't know any of your numbers. We don't know that this 50. I mean, I could come in here to the commissioners and say, I want to put an addition on my house, and I want $10,000 from the county, and surely I'll invest money in the county. Surely I'll hire people from the county to do that, and surely the value of my home will go up to repay the $10,000. But you know what? I don't need money from the county. I can afford to do that myself. I don't need it. There's lots of people in this county that can't afford lots of things. And county employees have had their wages frozen. They've had to take furlough days for free. The county, you know what the situation the county's in. And yet you say you need the money, but you're not willing to disclose any figures as to why you need the money. So I'll let that go. I mean, we can argue this forever. But I'm just saying right now you haven't shown a need for the money. I mean, and I agree with this gentleman right here. I mean, I'm tired of these incentives, and I wish there was a ban completely on this because it puts commissioners in a very difficult position, the old prisoner's choice dilemma. But in any event, my understanding is this money is going to be used for used equipment. Is that correct? Is it used equipment you're putting in this plan?
There could be some used, there could be some new, and there's a lease that's the majority of the equipment is with a lease.
So it's leased equipment?
Leased equipment today.
Okay. So you're going to get a tax write-off on the leased equipment. I take exception, I guess, to a comment here, paragraph, one of the whereases in this contract. County finds that reimbursing the company for a portion of its construction and equipment costs will increase the taxable property base for Alamance County. I mean, I tried to get some ideas from Mr. Honeycutt on this. I have no numbers on that either. It's used equipment. It's leased. Are you buying from another subsidiary of your own company? I mean, this is from another company that maybe has gone bankrupt in this industry. I don't know. But in any event, I can't even see how this is going to even be evaluated to refund the county on this. I just have to oppose this. I mean, you know, I'm glad you're bidding on the contract. I know there have been hundreds of people who have lost jobs in this industry over a number of years. You all get good salaries. I mean, I'm assuming you all get good salaries. I would oppose it because there's no need here, at least no demonstrated need. It's nice to be able to give these companies money. Oh, they're guaranteed. I'd love to give her lots of money. But this county is going through some tough financial times. And, I mean, aren't you a part of the discussion about how government is broke, how government has to cut spending, how government can't afford to be providing services to everyone, especially those people that don't need it? I mean, you're part of that discussion, I imagine, every day. And yet you come here to government, who many people consider to be an anchor to the economy, but you come here to government for money, for free money. This is free money. And these are jobs that you should, you're not here to hire people, you're here to make profits. You need to hire the people in order to make those profits. So don't come here masking this as if you're creating jobs for some altruistic kind of purpose. It's not, it's to make money on this contract. And so far I haven't even seen any demonstration for need on this. And I'll oppose this, as I usually do on these.
Thank you, Peter. How about the, yes sir, come forward. Welcome.
Thank you, Chairman Manning. Be sure I get that right. Thank you. Thank you, Commissioners, for the work you do. Thank you, Manager Honeycutt, and your staff for the, I think, excellent work you're doing for Alamance County. I'm Sammy Moser. I'm a sort of nervous, concerned taxpayer. I've worked and lived in Alamance County for over 50 years, paid taxes. And I want to commend these gentlemen for their professional success. Thank you for being a part of Alamance County. I mentioned to met Robert, spoke with him briefly, had to tell him that I'm on the opposite side of the fence when it comes to their wanting incentives. I questioned him as to why couldn't they just borrow the money from the bank instead of wanting taxpayers' revenues to finance this business. And I'd ask Mr. Manning, you were a leading banking official. How many banks do we have in Alamance County?
Too many.
Okay, so, but 8, 10, how many would be?
Yeah, at least
8 to 10. How many banks counting credit unions? Yeah, there's.
So that was my question. These banks, aren't they lending money now? And that's my concern. And I would ask the gentleman to consider borrowing the money like each individual here would have to do if we were going to purchase property, buy a house. We would have to finance our own purchase. If folks that are working with Furrow Foods, is it okay to just mention that incentive issue? If they choose to move to Alamance County, to Mebane, to continue working for Furrow Foods, who we gave them incentive money to, are you commissioners in a position to help these individuals purchase property like we did for the food company? I just think incentives are, it's a bad deal for the average working taxpayer. I just think it's unfair. Ronnie, I think it was, mentioned that we're only talking about $500, and that seems like a very simple figure, which maybe it is. We all want to create jobs in the county. But I'd just like to share with you a Burlington Times News article. This goes back to 2004, and it says, corporate share of tax burden is shrinking. 2004. It said corporate income taxes are paying for a shrinking share of state services, leaving North Carolina workers to make up the difference. That's you, Sheriff, Ronnie, that's each of us. Leaving us to make up the difference. I come here as a concerned taxpayer for Eddie's Commissioner Boswell's grandchildren coming along. They're going to be taxpayers in the future. Chairman Massey, has a granddaughter that will soon be graduating from Elon University, and we are so proud of her. She's going to be in the workforce, and I think it's unfair to these young folks going in the workforce if we keep adding more and more tax burden on them and giving more tax relief to corporations. It just seems unfair. I know Mr. Williams spends a lot of time, valuable time, trying to solicit business and actually trying to give away tax dollars is what it appears to be, but that's his job. But I just think it's unfair to the taxpayers. Had a list that I went back through for several years, corporations that we have given money to. One actually started in 2006, Continental Corporation. I think all of you know the history of that bad situation. And so this right here could be, hopefully, not that type situation, but it sounds like we don't quite know all the details about the company and what could happen in the future. We gave incentives to Sandit Corporation in 2008. I think it could total $1 million. And just recently, they had to curtail their business because of the economy. So it's hard to predict what any company, their success or failure could be in the future. I'm just asking you to, I'm not sure, I was here at the last meeting when you went in closed door session, and I hate to say it, but I just assumed when you came out of the session that your vote was already determined as to what you were going to do without getting public input. I hope I'm wrong on that. But so I'm not really asking you. I think it would be wrong to give money to these folks, taxpayers' money. I think my main concern is, we hear everybody, Commissioner Boswell, talking about incentives should be outlawed. A couple years ago, I heard a former state senator from Gastonia say the same thing. He said the federal government should outlaw the incentives. And so I'm just asking our commissioners, maybe consider a new direction along with Mr. Williams as to how we could change the direction of giving taxpayers' money out to corporations. See if we couldn't come up with resolutions and go to our congressmen, state representatives. Try to start making some changes for the future. So thank you for time to speak. Have a final question that, in looking back through Burlington Times News notes, I saw that in 2006 a question had been asked, where are incentives going to stop? Where are they going to stop? And I would ask each of you the same thing today. It just seems unfair that counties compete against other counties. It would be unfair if Mr. Honeycutt had to compete Alamance County against Buncombe County, where his family is. I think it's unfair for Alamance County to compete against Guilford County. We got friends and relatives in Guilford County. We don't want to cause their taxes to go up because we made a bid for a lab core, and Guilford County has more money than we do, so they could up their bid. But that's costing the taxpayers in Guilford County. So it's just real simple. I was a concerned citizen. Just want to speak out, and I, as the other gentleman, I commend you folks, and thank you for what you do. And it's not a, certainly I'm not speaking against you. I'm just speaking for average working taxpayers in Alamance County, and I'm thinking of the future kids that are coming along in our county who will be taxpayers. So thank you.
Thank you, Sammy. How about the last row? Any speakers from the last row? Yes, sir. Come forward. Introduce yourself, please. Welcome.
I'm Mike Wilson. I'm a lifelong resident of Alamance County, and I just wanted to voice my opposition against this incentive program. I am generally against government being involved in business, period, whether it's restrictions or in helping them. Mr. Boswell, you're in the building business just like I am. I think the latest figures, 17% of the cost of building a home is directly related to government regulations. I think we need to curtail that, and I think we need to curtail it on the other end, too. We don't need to subsidize business. I have a couple of questions. Is any of you board members have any financial interest in Burlington Technologies?
I do not.
I don't at all.
Does any board member wish to have a financial interest in Burlington Technologies?
I do not.
If you wouldn't invest your money, why will you invest ours?
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's good.
Thank you, Mike.
Okay. John, a rebuttal to your own comments?
One quick comment, if I may.
Sure.
I won't rant, because I appreciate these gentlemen's comments, because I don't know these gentlemen, but my impression of them is that they're honorable people and that I have a whole lot more in common with them than my intuition tells me that they think they have with me. I would like to just address the fact that I learned a lot of things from my dad, who was a World War II MP. And if he taught me anything, he taught me to plan for the worst and hope for the best. And he always taught me to look in the mirror if you got a problem. And so I appreciate these gentlemen's comments. But I would like to just take the rational thought back to this premise. If your toe, and I like metaphors because I'm a simple guy, and I think most people can relate to that, and they don't want to spend 3 days discussing these types of issues, they prefer 3 minutes. I totally agree with everything that they said about government incentives, but is it rational for good and decent men that I feel like these men are, as well as a lot of other people who agree with them, in principle, is it rational to say, don't do this because we are giving, maybe these gentlemen do have access to $55,000. I think personally, if I was the CEO of this company, I'd go out and take a personal loan, home equity loan, and fund this $55,000. But there could be micro issues that are so detailed that we are totally unaware of at my level, that gives them an incentive or a reason to do this. But the rationale behind my comments were this. This is going on in America. It's wrong, but if your toe was cut off, and I use Alamance County as having a toe cut off right now, and we're bleeding profusely, and 110 potential people have the opportunity for $500. I pay about $3,500 a year in city and county taxes. And I'm here to tell you that I don't like writing those checks. But if my neighbor for $500 can have a shot at getting a job and making $23,000 a year, I support that, especially with this one rational premise. And I don't know if this is valid. The accountants would have to tell me. Over the course of that 2-year period, is it rational to think that $500 per job is going to come back into the coffers of the county in one form or another? And whether or not we like it, I do not like these incentives. Is it rational to think that given the way the country has gone in the last 30, 40 years in my lifetime, that this incentive in and of itself would be a rational thing to approve? Even though I would think most of us here collectively do disagree with government being involved in private business. But I go back to my comments. Please address this at the state level and the federal level, because you guys have influence. And you're the ones that have the influence and the power. And instead of the little guy not being the recipient of maybe a good benefit here, let's take it like I'll be your campaign manager. we'll run you for Senate. And I will help you. Let's get these men in office to change it aggregately. Because if we do not change it aggregately, all we do is fight and fuse amongst ourselves. If I were in business, I'd ask. If you said no, I'd go next door. And if it's legal, right or wrong, ethical, some people think it's unethical. I don't. I don't agree with it. It's a reality. I would encourage you. I'm confident that I represent the vast majority of people that will not hold this against you for providing $55,000 worth of incentive to this company for the potential for 110, mostly people working out of Alamance County that will get these jobs. That's just my personal opinion. I didn't mean to do a rebuttal, but I thought it was important to say I think we're getting off on the micro issue here when there's an aggregate big picture.
people like me are very much against these incentives, but that's an aggregate decision that has to be addressed at the federal and the state level. You can't fix it here today by making a symbolic, emotional, or not an emotional, a convicted decision on, you know, how you just think these things are fundamentally wrong, which I agree with. And thanks for letting me ramble a little bit.
Thank you, John.
Mr. Chairman, are we into a rebuttal period then? Because I think I should get a second chance.
No, that was my term, and I probably used it in error. But you certainly made your points, as have John and the others, and
well,
we appreciate
sorry,
it.
But I really have to speak to those comments since the gentleman was allowed a second chance to speak.
Well, in my opinion, he didn't give anything new. All he did was repeat what he said
well,
before.
Well, he was talking about rationality of this decision.
Well, I
we don't know that it's rational because we don't have all the numbers from the company. Yeah, now, I'm willing to allow the question in closed session with commissioners and present all the numbers on the table if they don't want to disclose numbers from a private company. But we can't speak to the rationality of this decision when we don't know what the numbers are. We don't know what the company's sales are. We don't know what the profits of the company are. We don't know the terms of the contract. We don't know anything about this. They're just asking for $55,000. So speaking to rationality, and you know what? These are $23,000 a year jobs. Okay? How much? I mean, do you think that's a lot of money? I mean, it is not a lot of money. We should talk to social services and find out how many $23,000 a year people the county is helping out get through this economy. Because
well, it's a lot if you don't have any.
Okay, well, we're not going to have a public debate. So are there any other speakers who have not had the opportunity to speak who wish to at this time?
I move it. Close public hearing.
Robert?
He was asked if he wanted to speak.
Let me just make just a few comments.
I just want to make a few comments about Burlington Technologies. You know, Burlington Technologies is a new company in the community. We have 120 employees. Now, say we're a new company, but those employees has about an average of 30 years seniority working in our plants. You know, we started this company 4 years ago with borrowed money. We purchased another company called, we renamed Seven, the Williamsburg plant, with borrowed money. We've got a unique opportunity. We can put 110 people to work almost overnight. And we just need some money to help us purchase that equipment and relocate that equipment. And if we don't employ the 110 employees, you're not going to sign us the money. If we don't get the government contract, we're not going to ask for the money. But it's an opportunity. It's a unique opportunity. Think about it. It's not incentives for us to go out and build a building. And it's going to take years. In a month from now, if we don't have 110 people working, then we don't have the $55,000. We've asked our employees, it was talked about pain and suffering. We've asked our employees the last 4 years to take some pretty significant decreases in pay. We've asked our managers to take some significant decreases in pay. And here's an opportunity for us to hopefully become a more healthy company if we can put 110 employees and then later, hopefully by the end of the year, 140 employees to work. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. Tim, did you have a motion?
Mr. Chairman, just one quick comment, please.
Very quick.
Can we afford? Can Alamance County afford this? We're in, as these folks are, They're in dire need. We are too. And that's just all I ask you commissioners, each one, to think about. Can we afford this when we don't have the money to pay our own bills?
Thank you, Henry.
I move it to close to the public.
Is there a second?
I second it.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay, at this time the public hearing will be closed and we will turn this into the business meeting to discuss Burlington Technologies. And there were a couple of points raised that we probably need a little clarification on. One is the E-Verify system and eligibility. The second one is the length of the term of the contract. If you guys could maybe speak to those two, and then we'll turn it up open for the commissioner comments.
Originally, in the first draft we looked at, we talked about a four-year commitment on jobs, and then in our discussions, we discussed 3 years. And I do apologize not looking at the final draft that close. I would recommend to the board, if they're agreeable with it, is do a 3-year commitment on that at $110 for that period. So that would be change of section
11. Yeah, part 11.
To 2014. And also with respect to the E-Verify.
Women, let's take one at a time. Paul, you want to speak to that? Paul represents the company as legal counsel. Welcome.
Afternoon. We can just change that paragraph to make it a 3-year period.
Right.
And I think part of our discussion was us going back to the military and figuring out, because we're picking up what's left of a contract, figuring out exactly how much time was left on that contract. So 3 years is certainly agreeable with us.
Does that address Commissioner concerns on that part?
Satisfies
me.
Thank you, Paul.
And then also with respect to the E-Verify, we could give them wording that we use for our vendor contracts that they should be able to incorporate into this agreement. That would address the E-Verify issue. It's a very, very simple process to use. It's just a phone call, basically.
Yeah, I'm very familiar with that, and we'll certainly agree to do that.
What does state law call for? What I want to know.
Paul, my God.
I'm not familiar with any requirement for incentive contracts.
That's not the issue. The issue
we can
is
certainly
use an E-Verify for employees. You employ X amount of employees. Have nothing to do with incentives.
You mean like private industry?
Yes, private industry. Yeah. And it's not government related. It's not government. It's not who government hires to do work for government. This is for private enterprise, and it was passed in Raleigh, unless I'm sadly mistaken. And I want to know exactly the parameters of that, and I want it incorporated into this with my motion.
I'll have to get that information for you. I don't have it with me today, but I can get it for you.
And no offense, and I mean this with all due respect, I'm a little surprised that you didn't know what E-Verify was. And I knew that respect. I mean, that is a national process that's been on the burners for years. Every major industry should be involved in it. That's why our illegal immigration employee scenario is where it's at. And forgive me, I'm just surprised.
I would just say that we'll certainly agree to put that into the agreement. You know, it's my understanding that is a change that took place last summer. There's a phase-in period over 2 years as to who it applies to. And I'm very familiar with that program. You can tell Burlington Technologies hadn't been doing a lot of hiring over the last couple of years. It's been trying to hold on to the ones that they've had. But going through this process and also with the federal government contract, that'll be a part of it.
Well, now, if there's a phase-in period where there would be a window here where it wouldn't be used, I would want it used immediately.
And I think we could work it part of our local requirement.
Yeah, we'll agree to make it part of this agreement.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not a difficult process to go through at all.
No,
it requires the same information that HR would normally take, the I-9s and the background information. It just gives you a place to go verify that information independently as opposed to having a staff person verify it. So it protects the company as well.
Sure. Yeah. Because you don't want to be fined in the future big time for not.
That's absolutely right.
Doing what you need to be doing.
Yeah.
And I promise you that's coming. Not to you personally. I'd like to speak out now as Commissioner Cummings. I wasn't going to say anything except my four questions and wish him luck. But I'll tell you who fired me up was Mr. Oaks. I find it hard to believe that you think because our vote no would be symbolic, or that you even think that we can't start a grassroots movement at the local level. Look at the debate we have had today
5 years ago, nobody spoke out. Look at what's happening here today, and I promise it's going to continue. And to tell me that my vote is irrational, and that's basically what you said, if I voted no, I couldn't disagree with you more. I have voted against cash incentives for 5 to 6 years now, and I'm proud of my vote. I've been ostracized, I've been ridiculed, I've been classified as not progressive, against business, and so forth and so on. I resent that. They used to call them tax incentives until they probably realized that that's not a good word. Tax abatements are illegal. Why, if it's such a great process, why doesn't government just waive taxes for 2 to 3 years rather than have this Mickey Mouse process of not waiving the taxes but giving them the cash to equate what they paid in? That's Mickey Mouse. If a private business, if banks did, gave money for a contract, they'd go to jail for bribery, malfeasance. But in business, turn our head, everything's fine. My votes are never irrational as far as I'm concerned. I do my homework. I'm willing to stand alone. And this country wasn't founded on people pointing to somebody else saying, well, we can't make a change here. Let somebody else do it. Paul Revere, Patrick Henry, boy, they must have been crazy people. And I'm telling you now that it's a sad day when you have a state senator sit in the next room, as he did with me, and tell me he didn't realize we could do this. And we went to the next room and broke out a check for $37,000 that went to a company. Companies do this because they can do it. And they're willing to take the gamble, they're going to get it. And they do get it. They'll get it today, possibly. But I'll never forget a company in here that I voted against a big time, $250,000 tax incentive. Incentive. And I looked at them and I said, I can't believe for a moment that you're going to go down to Research Triangle Park and pay 40 to 50% more tax just because you can't get $250,000 today. Yes, I was outvoted, and that's fine. But when they walked out the door, a couple of them looked at me like, you're right. You're right, but we'll take it. That's the way I perceived the look that they had. As far as trying to get somebody to do something at the state or federal level, we passed in June of 2010, if I'm not mistaken, a resolution that I put forth asking that the state take it off the backs of the counties, take it off the backs of the cities who are competing against one another. Pay incentives to somebody to shut down a company in High Point, come over here. That passed unanimously. We didn't get a single response that I know of from anybody that went to. But I'll never believe that my votes are symbolic if I believe in what I believe in. And yes, it can start at the local level. All government's local and works its way up the ladder. And what I heard you say was it doesn't work local. You have no effect locally. I deducted that, or inducted that, whatever you want. But I couldn't disagree with you more that my vote is irrational, of no consequence, and that it's symbolic. I resent that, and I'm shocked that you had that opinion of what we're elected to do here.
Thank you, Tim. Other comments? Bless you. Are we in a position to set forth a motion regarding this issue?
I'll make a motion that we approve this 3-year contract with the requirements that we've asked. They've agreed to.
No, second that.
Okay, just to repeat the motion, the requirements that we've asked would include the amendment to use the e-verify system and to ensure that the contract is for 3 years.
3 years, that is correct.
I'll second that.
Seconded by Mr. Boswell. Motion made by Mr. Lashley. Any other comment or discussion among commissioners?
Nope.
If not, we'll call the vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Thank you. Okay, at this time, I would like to close this subject on Burlington Technologies. Thanks to all who came to the public hearing. You're welcome to hang around for the rest of the meeting. We will have an open, we will take a minute recess.
This is graduating scale.
I don't get it very often if I want to explain to you what I do. I think about it. I bet you enjoyed it.
Thank you. Happy New Year, Ray.
Okay, let's go ahead and resume. The door is closed. Again, thank you all for remaining here. As we do in our normal business meetings, we like to take the opportunity to invite public comment with anything that's on your mind, limited to 3 minutes. The only public comment request I had was from John Oates, and he was to speak at the public hearing, so I did not receive any other requests. At this time, I would like to then turn it over to two items from the Sheriff's Office, a budget amendment number 78, and also a request to transfer funds. Sheriff, welcome.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. I'm here before you today to ask you certainly for basically three things. One is I am asking that it's got a request for a transfer or budget amendment 78. We're asking because they're no longer making the Crown Vicks for police packages, and the equipment in our current Crown Vicks will not fit any other made car. Tahoes, the Impalas, and the small 4500 is now being made as a police package. And you're looking at about $2,500 a car just for the cage to go in the car. So I am asking that we be able to purchase. I have found 25. Of course, Lester's county manager said, "You're crazy. You ain't going to get 25. And that's fine. But we're asking what we're asking, I found 25 in South Carolina. They're the only ones that we found in the United States. And asking that we'd be able to purchase four from county money, and an additional three Crown Vicks and one Dodge Charger from federally transferred drug seized money that is not taxpayers' money. We've been very fortunate the last few years in the amount of revenue that we seized from our drug dealers here in Alamance County. We're asking that four be purchased from money be transferred to the line item for cars from our federal drug seized money, and then also be able to purchase four from some county money.
The county money that we're talking about, so $250,000 we had set aside in a contingency, with, as the sheriff said, it's about a 10% savings right now to do it, and they're vehicles that we were going to have to look at one way or the other, especially in next year's budget. I don't even want to know how many he's going to ask for, but this would put a small dent, and also at a 10% savings was the reason why I would recommend to the board looking at this.
Any questions for the sheriff or our county manager?
I've had somebody approach me in regards to the money there. Can you explain what the money is allowed to be used for?
Yes, sir. First of all, it cannot supplant any budget line item in the department. Secondly, it has to be used for equipment or training, or hiring you have to pay the first year of an employee's salary, and after that first year, then the county has to pick it up. We've never done that because the county's not been able to pick a salary up, but it has to be used for equipment or training for law enforcement. And we've been very fortunate over the past few years. The county's not been able to give us a lot of cars, but we've tried to supplement buying cars out of federal monies, but not supplementing the budget. For instance, I'll talk to Mr. Honeycutt and say, you know, you're going to allow me to get any cars next year. Well, we can't get you but two, we can't get you but three. Well, fine. Can you guarantee me those three? Because once he guarantees me that, then I can... That's not for planning, but then I can use the federal money. But he says, no, you can't get but two, and we've put three in the budget. I'm not able to get two. I cannot buy any cars out of federal money from that point on until the next year. And so we're faced here with a situation. First of all, we need the cars. Second of all, they stopped making the Crown Vicks. Hopefully, down the road, they'll start making them back. They did that one time before, but what really burns me up is the equipment that we're having these cars. And believe me, we've got 63 Crown Vicks in our fleet, and not a single cage is going to fit in the Ford 500s or the Impalas or the Tahoes. So hopefully, the cars we get, if we're allowed to get them, by the time they expire their use in the county, they will go back and make Crown Vicks again. That's what Ford does every now and then. So, you know, one year they left the Crown Vic and went to a Taurus. Guess what? Same situation existed.
What's the cost to upfit one of the...
Are you talking about total outfit one of our cars?
Where you can't reuse parts from one
to... About $2,500 per car.
So you're going to save that if we continue using the Crown Vic.
Per car. And if we don't see, then when we do get cars, if it's next year's budget, then we've got to buy new cages and bar lights, et cetera.
So. Sheriff, when you stepped to the podium, you said you wanted to cover three things, but there's two items on our agenda.
Well, actually, there was probably a third on the purchase of cameras.
That's probably included in transfer.
For years, we have needed cameras in our cars. And I will tell you this, it saves hours and hours on the internal investigations. It's also very, very good to have these videos to play in court for evidence in car chases, armed robberies, et cetera. And I've been fighting for 10 years. I've been sheriff, so I've tried to get these cameras. We finally got enough federal drug seize money in that we can get the cars we're asking for, plus asking that $174,930.04 be transferred to be able to put cameras in our patrol cars. Now, I'm going to tell you why I think the urgency is. You folks know that DOJ has been here in the past couple of years, 3 years, seemed like a lifetime to me. And we have a situation where they tried to set up one of our deputies. So I won't say DOJ tried to set him up, but the group here tried to set the deputy up. Thank goodness he did exactly what it was supposed to be, because once he stopped the car was going down the road, give a left-hand turn signal, wouldn't turn, gave a right-hand turn signal, wouldn't turn, speed up, slow down, find a deficit, must be lost. People must be lost. Turned on the blue light as soon as he got out and approached the window, up pulls another car with a video camera. Video. Deputy done exactly what it was supposed to be. Cameras on these cars, and I'll be honest with you, can save the sheriff a lot of headaches, the county a lot of headaches. And I'm asking that you allow us to be able to do this. You have the bids that's in here. We're going to be coming off of Burlington's contract with them, and the money's there with federal drug seize monies. Please, if you have any questions, ask.
You have none in the cars at all now, right?
We have about four that has been gotten off of federal grants, like our when we did a what we call our patrol cars that worked the interstates and stuff. We were able to get I think about four cameras we have in our cars now.
Just to be honest, would you imagine that we're one of the last counties not to have cameras in our cars?
You know what really got me was Mr. Honeycutt said, "What? Y'all don't have cameras? We've had cameras down where I come from for 5 or 6 years."
Now, this will put them in each car?
In our patrol cars. I'm going to put them in every car, but as money comes in, we will probably be back there, but it will put them in our patrol cars, our frontline cars.
How many total were those? Was it? I didn't see it exactly.
I had that on my mind. I can't even think.
150.
I think it's 28 cars that were actually 28 cars.
That's what it says, 28. 28.
When I was in Fletcher, we had cameras in 98.
Wow.
Anybody who's watching the evening news should know how important cameras are.
Let me tell you something. I will probably save, in a month's time, employees' hours, probably 50 to 70 hours on complaints. Give you a good example. I had a lady come in, and thank God we had a camera in this car. It said, your officer, and I won't call his name, stopped me for no reason at all, cussed me like a dog. And of course, I interviewed the lady. I already had the videotape before she come in the office. And she come in, and I took a formal complaint from her, went back over it, make sure exactly what she said it was. I said, well, ma'am, I want to show you something. I flicked on the videotape. She run out of the office like she was on fire. She jumped out of the car. She was flying past the deputy. And you know, he really wasn't going to give her a ticket. But anyway, she ran from the office, and I hadn't seen her since. So these can stop a lot of internal investigation, a lot of man hours for our deputies, and also protect the county in lawsuits.
Any other questions for the sheriff? Would the board be receptive to entertaining a single motion to cover all three of these items?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Tim. Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank you, Albert.
Mr. Chairman, if I could the sheriff talk a little bit about the misdemeanors, if you don't mind, sir?
The what?
The misdemeanors and the contract and looking at working with the state to bring this
back into
account. I received the contract this morning from the Division of Correction, Probation and Parole to sign. We have approximately 80 beds open at any given time in Alamance County because of our federal system. The leniency out of Washington, D.C., releasing some of your criminal immigrants because of, the pressure from the political situations in Washington, and I'm not going to go there. But what I want to let y'all know is we have an opportunity. I've agreed, if everybody's okay with it, to house these inmates at $40 a day, local misdemeanors, not just from Alamance County, but surrounding counties, because we have 80 beds open. Now, my position is, when the president changes and the immigration laws tighten, then we can stop holding them at any given time and become back holding more federal inmates, both U.S. Marshal and your criminal immigrants through ICE. $40 a day will about break us even, because all the medical is paid directly, is charged directly to Raleigh. We have cards that when they're taken to outside medical sources, the bill goes straight to the Sheriff's Association. And then it's paid through the legislature, which is they have tacked on some court fees to help pay the $40 for holding these local inmates. Biggest thing I want to do is fill the let's fill the beds and be status quo, because we probably won't make nothing, but we won't lose a whole lot there. If we start losing, I can tell you, I'm gonna back out.
Well, now with that, you'd be using the other facilities.
Yes, sir. Be using the other facilities,
right?
Mm-hmm. And believe it or not, we probably have the most beds open to any sheriff's office in the state right now. And Sheriff Barnes will have some, but he says he's not going to hold them because it costs him more. Now, let me say this. The reason it costs him more, he has a much bigger staff than we do. We've been told by Mr. Mark Murphy from Charlotte we're 20% leaner on the detention staff in any jail in the state. And I'm just saying that because our people are working hard.
Well, the Greensboro News and Record article, I thought it was quoting about the same per day cost as what we've got within $2.
Exactly.
And he said he still wasn't going to do it.
Yeah. There's a headache for a sheriff, but at the same time, when you've got employees and a place open, you've got the beds. If you don't do it, I think we're slapping our taxpayers in the face.
Well, how many do you think will be put over there?
Oh, I guarantee they'll fill every bed. They got to find room for 1,500 that's currently in the system. And they're going to start January 1, the people getting sentenced, start plugging them in as they're getting sentenced to the surrounding counties here to Alamance County.
You think there's no way to put people in those beds that would pay more, whether it be ICE, the felons, the marshals, or even prisoners from other counties?
First of all, as a result of the Racial Justice Act, we do not hold any felons in our jail. Any convicted felon from January on goes straight to Central Prison. Secondly, I have called ICE, I have called the U.S. Marshal, the same situation is hit both of those identities, ICE and the Marshals, if the federal system is hoping for money. So what they're doing, what they used to get, they would be sentenced in Greensboro, say a U.S. Marshal prison. They'd be brought to our jail and left here for 4 to 6 weeks before they transfer them out to a federal prison. Now, as soon as they're sentenced, they grab them and take them on because they don't want to pay the money to the local institutions. ICE has come around and releasing people that they normally wouldn't release simply, I think, because of the political pressure from some of the groups.
And Mr. Chair, if I could say that in working with the sheriff, we believe $40 is much lower than the state originally talked about. And we have contacted our local delegation, talked to them about seeing where that cost and how it got there, because originally they were talking anywhere between $50 and $60, and they bumped that back to $40. So once we were redoing and looking at our average cost per day for inmates, so we can have some information that we can carry back to our delegation and say, listen, this is unfair and the state does need to do something. So we are working on that. And once we get those final figures, we'll bring them back to you.
How many employees are going back over there?
There'll be three on shift, four shift.
So it's 12 people?
12 people.
Are you anticipating having to hire anybody else because we do this?
No, sir. No, sir. Those are the employees that kept it when it was full. You know, we used to hold U.S. Marshal prisoners. Now, I will tell you, Commissioners, what I intend to do. I intend to take some of them misdemeanors, and I'm going to work out them picking up trash on the road. I don't care what county they're from, and doing work around the county here if we can. That's one way we can save money for the county.
Yes, sir.
And laying that bed all day long and eat 3 meals a day.
And not good for them.
Not good for money.
How many ICE people do you have?
I think today we had 43, I believe it was today.
Mm-hmm.
We had 8 come in over the weekend.
Why have we become so, I hear the political side of this that you're referring to, but why have we become so lowballish here? I mean, in other areas, are keeping literally hundreds of them, and I don't understand it.
No, sir. Let me tell you, we are getting ready to enter into agreement. We're supposed to meet in the morning to go down east with our people, go way down east picking up the people they're picking up. What's happened, and I'll just tell you my personal opinion, is that law enforcement agencies are scared to do their job because of what's happened here. You know, like I said, we've been sued here and they're afraid to do it, but the law is the law and we're going to enforce the law in this county. Some of the others, they'd rather write a ticket and let them go, don't care who they are. Well, that's wrong, because when they're called out in court, we're spending taxpayers' money looking for somebody that does not exist, that has given you a wrong name. And the sheriff has to find these people. I had a state official and a state law firm tell me he didn't care. He didn't have to hunt for them. I said, no, but I do, when they don't show up in court. And what you're looking for is a person's name that don't exist. But I think that's what's happened statewide. I know a sheriff in a nearby county gave up 287G program. He said, I'm tired of the headaches with it. Do the right thing for the right reason. And I think the law's the law. And if you're going to wear a badge, you need to enforce it.
City of Burlington does the same thing.
Yeah. I'm not going to go there.
Please put that in your report. City of Burlington does the same thing. They turn them loose. They write them a ticket and let them go. That's a fact.
Who's over detention in the state and removal? Is that out of Charlotte now or Raleigh?
No, that's out of Raleigh, Kerry. And that's right now, they're wanting us, they're trying to get rid of two other agencies that have been picking up people for them and bringing them in. What I'm and let us do the transportation down east and stuff. What I've got to look at, can we at least break even or make a little money by doing that? And the only way we can is we transport people that have been sentenced in Alamance County to Newbern Correctional Center and different places down there. If we can make a run dropping them and pick the feds up, then fine. But I'm not going to lose money.
Well, I don't blame you. Nobody's losing money, though, if they price it right.
You're right.
And I just believe, no offense, you know I'm a straight person. I believe you're straight.
Sir.
I believe we've de-emphasized it somewhat here. I believe that.
You mean the sheriff's office?
I believe that we haven't
pushed as hard as we could have pushed to get more in here. I believe that. And I'm sorry.
I'm telling you, I've talked to them in Washington, D.C. I've even been in Washington, D.C., sat down with them. I've talked to them in Atlanta. They've come up here. And the situation is that they're releasing them and not holding them. Like I said, we are a over 72-hour holding facility. There's other facilities in it. We're the only over 72-hour holding facility. Well, then what's happening, those that are being taken into custody are being released before 72 hours. So they're never making it to our facility unless we take them in custody here in Alamance County.
Well, if you price it right, you don't lose money. You make money. Right. Because they don't expect us to do it free.
No, sir.
And again, there's places where they're gangbusters with it, and there's some where, like us, we're keeping a piddly amount. And I just, we built the jail to house, with outdoor reservation, ICE, INS, ICE people. We had four people come down from Charlotte and sit and tell us that we'll do what they want us to do within reason, that they'll give us all we can hold. And it just went from that down to nothing almost. And then now we got to accept 80 some people. Don't have to accept. But we're accepting 80 some people where I think we're going to lose money.
Well, I will tell you this. My intentions are when that population, federal, starts building up, state population is going to go down in Alamance County Detention. I have done everything I possibly can, Mr. Fett, to get ICE inmates in here from other areas of the state. But everybody, everywhere said that population has gone down nationwide. Check and see.
Well, last time I called down to Edwards County in Alabama, they went from 200 when we went down there up to 400.
Okay, but let me tell you about Edwards, Alabama. See, they have no other holding for any longer than 72 hours in them states down there. Mm-hmm. So they get all that coming into them.
Well, I think that we need to make 100%, you say we are, I pray that we are, give it 100% effort to get more in here. In my opinion, it cures not only a financial, fiscal scenario, and we won't have to keep 80-some people at a loss, and I think we would be, and you're curing a socioeconomic ill that needs to be cured in America, and we'll be doing our part.
I agree.
I just hope that we're doing all that we can.
Well, the only thing we could do different, which is they call it profiling, just grabbing around up people, and we can't do
that. Well, I'm not suggesting that.
Well, I know that, but I'm just saying, that's the only way. I can't speak for North Carolina Highway Patrol. I can't speak for Burlington, Graham, Melvin, Hall River, or Elon. I can tell you, my people are doing what they should do, and that is if they catch a person violating the law, they bring them to the Alamance County Jail to be processed. A ton is never making it to the Alamance County Jail. I can tell you that, but not by my people.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think after the election, if it goes the way that it should go, we won't have much excuse at all.
We won't have any, I don't think.
To not be able to have our hands on more, because I think you're going to see a total change in philosophy.
I totally agree with you.
Yeah. If the electorate's
intelligent. Now, Sheriff, when you go out and pick these people up that have skipped out of coming to court, you process them then? Is that...
Yeah. What? No. What? No. If we can get them, yeah. If we can find them, yes, right. We don't know who you're looking for.
Right.
The sad thing is, usually, if we pick them up here in Alamance County, we process them, find them to be here illegally, and ICE lets them go on a promise to appear. They leave here, go to another state or to another county.
Okay.
We never see them yet. If they get caught, then they will be deported, because if they're caught and they didn't show up in court, then there's something they can do to them.
So you really never find them. You just have to go through the process to try to find them.
Exactly. Because I'm going to tell you, you go out here looking for false address, false name, it's hard to find. The only way you'll ever get them is if you catch them on a traffic violation, DWI, or robbery, or rape or something, bring them in and fingerprint them. Again, that's who it shows the real name.
Maybe these new cameras, you can get them to smile when you stop.
We can get a face.
Sheriff, just a minute. Point of order, the request, if that requires commissioner approval, we do not have that as an agenda item for action. I would prefer to receive your report is information.
Well,
does it need an?
It doesn't require board approval on that. It's really a.
I feel like that approval of the commissioners.
Right. Well, we receive this as information then, and I would say consensus wise, grant what you're asking, but I hesitate to have a board motion and second.
You don't need one.
What I would ask the board to do, if agreeable to the sheriff, is after we meet with our local delegation and kind of go over them what our figures are per day, is that we bring that back as a resolution to the board and say, listen, you're charging $40 per day. We just went through this, and it's costing us $50 per day, that the state of North Carolina needs to do something to make this a break even for all counties. So we would definitely bring that back to you.
You okay with all that?
Yes, sir. However, let me just say this now. Am I saying go on and sign the contract? We can break the contract anytime we want to. All we got to do is say we run out of it.
So it's that's all in the contract.
That's stipulation. They can say we don't want you to keep no more.
I got you.
So what we're saying is administratively, that's your call.
Okay. Yep. That's what I was saying.
We got 80-some people down in Raleigh from this county?
No.
Or Mr.
We're going to be taking that meet from all surrounding counties.
Some other counties?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's why I say, if we're going to, and like I say, I'm looking at it hard. If we're going to lose money, I'm not letting taxpayers of Alamance County pay for some inmate out of Gifford.
You're losing money. That's why B.J. Barnes said he wasn't going to do it.
Yeah, let me say, when you're talking
blank, we're not going to lose money.
Well, yeah, you're right. But when you're looking at the overall scheme of losing money, you have to figure the entire detention budget per number of inmates you have to get for a year to give you the approximate cost of inmates per day. BJ has a much bigger staff, and I don't mean to say that the commissioners haven't been good, because you have a much bigger staff than we do. They have more guards per, say, 10 inmates than we do. Therefore, their cost is going to be higher. You understand what I'm saying?
Well, again, their per day cost was about $2 difference from ours, from what I saw in the article.
We're going to have the same.
Not a ton.
Yeah. It looks like to me we're going to have the same number of guards, whether we have those people or not. We got the space. I don't see that it's going to cost the county anything.
I
disagree. That's not the issue. If you didn't have 80 people over there and you got 12 people that's coming over, and I'm not trying to fight the sheriff here, but I'm not going to sit on this. If you got 12 people that's not there now, and you put 80 and you're not going to hire nobody else, and you bring those 12 over, well, in business, I think you don't need those 12.
That's what I think, too.
Okay.
I agree.
So it's a decision as to whether we want to keep people or loss of money over there that don't even reside, that weren't even sentenced out of this county. And I have a problem with that, as B.J. Barnes did. And
if
so,
we got 12 extra people and we got a problem. Are we voting on this today?
No, it's not
a decision by the sheriff. This was for an FYI.
Yeah, the situation is, Mr. Sutton, one reason that I entertain doing this is that I feel for sure there's going to be a change in the way the federal system is handling immigration down the road. Okay, if we close that place, lay off 12 employees, then we got to turn right around 10, 11 months, hopefully, and hire 10, 12 more employees, go back and redo the things over the unit back up.
You're right. I want a change in that administration for the federal government, because.
Well, I just want some doggone leadership and immigration.
Amen.
I don't know who it is.
Nice to have. Yeah.
Thanks, Sheriff.
Thank you.
Okay. Item number 6, commissioner comments. Are there any other comments?
I gotta go.
Announcements. We have one. This was left on our desk Wednesday of this week at 10 a.m. There's going to be a ribbon cutting for the first electric vehicle charging station at a North Carolina transportation rest area, and that location is at one of our own rest stops. And it appears to be on the eastbound side of the interstate, on the western side of the county. This event will mark the formal ribbon cutting, one of the first electric vehicle charging stations to operate in North Carolina rest area. Electric vehicle charging stations have been recently installed for public use at the Alamance County rest area, as well as the rest area
located near I-95, I-40 Junction near Benson. Both locations garner more than 1 million visitors each year. Stations were provided by Raleigh-based Praxis Technologies through a grant from the North Carolina Department of Commerce Green Business Fund Program. January 11th, ribbon cutting will be hosted by Praxis Technologies. Feature speakers from the North Carolina Departments of Transportation and Commerce. Following the remarks, a Nissan Leaf will be available for demonstration, courtesy of Michael Jordan, Nissan, and Durham. That is this week, this Wednesday at 10 o'clock, the eastbound rest area. If there are no other announcements, we stand adjourned.